exactly at 2:30. Welcome to this keynote block, the next keynote block of the conference, which is the last one. I would say there's not so much to say from my side about the conference and all these things. I hope you and the food and everything all right here. Now it's a pleasure to not speaking about business, not speaking about architecture, not speaking about development, but speaking about quality and testing. So the next keynote is about exploratory testing. It's about interfaces, but some interfaces are not visual, and by accident we happen to be at an API conference where we deal with lots of not so really graphical and visual interfaces. Having said that, I would say please welcome Marit Pierre-Ravi. Hopefully I did it right. Give her a hand, please. Thank you.
Hello, everyone. I learned in my previous talk here today what I should frame myself in particular for this talk. I would call myself what you know as a manual QA, and that might be something that you understand hopefully a little bit better and a little bit differently after this talk is done. So we'll be talking about exploratory testing and computer interfaces in particular, because I find that the way the world has changed with having so much of the APIs around, us building microservices and orchestrating microservices, it's not like the user interface is what we play with anymore. It's the whole set of whatever bits and pieces we've built. And in order to get early feedback, that's definitely what we will need to be doing. So we'll talk about exploratory testing, and I define exploratory testing by the words of Elisabeth Hendrickson, and she defines it as this rigorous, systematic approach on finding and discovering risks by using both analysis techniques, you know, looking at things, figuring out what they do, but also coupling it with what we call testing heuristics, which is basically a lot of information condensed over use of various kinds of technologies in various kinds of environments, knowing what kind of things are we supposed to look at. So I could do a whole session on heuristics alone. There's great articles. I actually suggest that you would go up and look for them. There was just a recent one published on Ministry of Testing, one of the testing sites, and it's a nice introduction into that side of things. But exploratory testing, for me, it's basically, like, if I frame it in some way, it looks a little bit like this. On the center of everything testing, there is someone called a tester. I don't care if they're a full-time tester. I don't care if they're called a manual QA. I don't care if they're called a tester. They might be called a developer. But it's someone who is performing testing. That's the core of exploratory testing. And that person is in full control. Not someone who was, you know, managing or planning things or creating test cases for them, but that person in that moment, what they're doing is they're looking at the application and they're making choices. They're learning with every single test that they're performing. So everything that they see changes what they might do next. They might see an API give a response that they didn't quite expect, and it might make them, you know, tweak a little bit on the input parameters so that they would get more of a response that they did expect, figuring that out. And this sounds like a thing that we do around just building APIs. So testing, exploratory testing, is not something that just testers do. But the way we frame it, the work of exploratory testing, is usually that it's, you know, it consists of days of work. You come to work in the morning, you leave the office, hopefully after 7.5 hours, actually 8 hours plus or minus the lunch break. And during that day, you're supposed to be doing something useful in some structural way. And the way that I often structure is these four different boxes that we talk about here. You need to have an idea. Why did they hire you? What kind of things are expected of you? What kind of features are you looking at? What kind of information are you providing? The current charters, what are you thinking of doing right now? What is it that you're gonna have done by the end of today? And that could look very different. Then details as you're testing, you make notes of, oh, I see this is not quite as I expected. I'm learning a new thing here. I am seeing something that I want to remember later on. This wasn't quite as obvious as I thought. Like all the learning that is going on. You make notes of those, and you make notes of ideas. And like, oh, I'm not going to do this testing right now. I'm going to do that tomorrow. And that's what other charters is. And there's just basically the structure of things going on at whatever order you, the tester, chooses. That's exploratory testing. And a lot of times people frame this into like, you know, we need these management frameworks around this so that we can even understand how this goes on in organization. And the first thing that you need is, of course, bug reports. It could be a conversation with someone who fixes that, quite my preference, rather than writing a report on it. You might want to track all of your ideas of charters, what kind of things you would be exploring. You could create some kind of documentation for future. You could create some metrics. You could have someone helping grow in these kind of skills. And just, you know, you can vote on how do we perceive quality just with thumbs traffic lights, color codes. So this is the world of exploratory testing that I know from 25 years in that type of roles, what I would call a manual QA. And in that role, what I do is I look at the product. I think of it as my external imagination. And I just wanted to show you a little bit of a demo on what that actually looks like. So in order to keep things somewhat simple, I took a very, very typical thing that an exploratory tester, a manual QA, could do. And this is a little kata so that it helps us kind of keep things focused. And we very clearly have an interface here, a user interface or a code interface or an API on a level of one method. So I can see, you know, just looking at it, it already is tweaking tweaking my interest in the sense that I can see there's something. It has a name. It might mean something. It might not mean something. But it has three boxes that I'm supposed to fill. So, you know, in my head, if I'm used to seeing user interfaces, this is just a user interface, just like any of the other ones. I am supposed to use this check item thing, putting in things called item, sell-in, and quality. And if I want to know what it does, I actually have a specification for this. I'm not going to make you read it, but I'm going to tell you the basic story of it. This is a shop. It's a shop that sells various kinds of items. So the items are names of items. Sell-ins are how many days you can still sell it. And quality is how valuable is it at that particular time. So I can give these values in. I can check what I get out. And I've had a very friendly and nice developer creating me a single test already that I can run and see how things work. So if I put in something 0 and 0, it seems that, well, the quality that I get out is a 0. So just running it, seeing that it still works. So I'm an exploratory tester. I might be now interested in it. Like I can start from various angles. I can think of like, you know, just generating whatever values and seeing what comes out of it. I might not even care what the values are. That's one of my options. I could read the specification. That's an option as well. Or I could go and look at the code and come up with some of the choices that I make based on that. And again, no one outside is telling me which of these three I have to do. I have probably my own preferences, but my strongest preference is always to do something different than I did last time, because that enables me to learn new things, surprising things, and be kind of on the way of serendipity. So I can play with this, just, you know, I can see from here that there's other things, like, for example, there's a thing called aged brie, which is supposed to increase in quality. So what if I just change it here? 0 and 0, well, it goes old. Probably it's then going to be going up in value. I don't know if this is how it works, but I can just, you know, see it. Okay, actually, it went up in value by 2. I don't know if that's right or not, but this is how the code right now works. So I can, you know, make a note of, I think it should go up by 1, or I can, you know, figure out a little bit more on what does it do. But we don't have much of a baseline on what it even does. The 0, 0 that we started with didn't really give us much of anything. So the 0, 0 doesn't tell if this something thing would actually be, you know, working normally in a normal case. So we started off with it already being old, and it already being of no value. So let's rather have it of some value and not yet old. Why did I put 3 and 6? Because I felt like it. The only reason that I had on putting two different numbers is that for me to track where the numbers actually are used, it is a lot easier if they are not symmetrical. So these are all these kind of heuristics, ways of thinking around this application. So again, I can see that it gives me now a 5. So it seems to be going down by 1 if it is number of days. So instead, what if I had it already getting old? Is it now getting old faster? I got now 4, so it goes down by 2. So maybe yeah, the aged brie was fine as well. What you can notice right now, that what I'm doing is I am not keeping any of my values. The ones that I have created, the test cases here, I didn't keep any of them. Most of the time when I do this demo, I actually copy-paste new test cases and I create all of this separately. But what I would rather show you is that I really hate copy-paste. Whenever I have to explore, I really try to avoid copy-paste. So I would rather use, this is a tool called approval tests, and in particular combination approvals. So I already saw the aged brie. We already tried sell-in values of 0 and 3. And we already saw qualities of 0 and 6 in the inputs. So if I now run this, it just generates me all the options that I had. And again, you know, since I'm exploring, I can again look at things that, you know, what I put in, something 0 and 0, what I got out, something minus 1 and 0. So this is actually already revealing to me that the days are going down by 1, and it seems to be a pattern in all of these that the days are going down. So having full visibility to over whatever we are doing is enabling me to learn more and give me kind of like targets of what kind of things I might be doing. So for me to now look at this, I can say, I like this. These are all correct. At least it's how the application is working right now. We haven't yet changed it. It was working in production. So I could also say I'm just, you know, making my notes, making my observations, having my discussions, and leaving those behind. And now I can again see that, okay, so those tests are now passing. I have documented some of the observations that I created. I can also run this under coverage. Like obviously I would put my environment in that kind of a shape. And I could see that, you know, the little things that I have so far created don't get me much of a coverage. And if you're looking at the specification below, the backstage passes seems to be a shorthand of what is actually in the implementation. I might write a book about that, or I might not. Again, my choice. I am in control of what is relevant to bring out of the session. But I would definitely want to take this value in to whatever tests we have. And again, now I'm curious on what changes. And I got a few new tests. So things with that backstage pass, if I put in a 3 and a 6, which seems like a nice thing to have, I am getting out values of 2. Okay, so goes down by 1 the day, seems like a right thing. And 9 goes up by 3. So there was a rule around these specific concerts saying that when it approaches the deadline, it actually grows up in value more. Remembering that rule that I do remember because I did read the specification, this is okay as well. So I could again say just that, you know, I approve all of this. I'm not going to be fully testing this. I could do that quite easily by just adding numbers here. Let's say 5, I know there was a 10, 11 sounds like a good thing. Since 10 was a limit, I will use that one as well. So this might be more of what you're used to thinking of as in exploratory testing, just coming up with boundary values and things that are perhaps relevant. Let's say 1 because it feels like a good number as well. And just have here also some numbers like 50 and 80 are supposed to be some limits. And again, I can just generate all of this. Now I would have 144 test cases. It's going to take me a while if I'm going to verify that all of this is correct. But I could also say that, you know, since this was supposed to work before you made any changes, and the changes are just coming, I am just doing my exploring to make sure that you're not breaking anything later on. So I have now 144 test cases. But basically what I'm just doing is exploring. As an exploratory tester, I would really love to do things like, oh, numbers, integers. This is a number. This is an integer. It's just a binary number. So what about that? What happens? And I would learn that, okay, binary numbers, well, they are binary numbers, and they're turned into non-binary. And it's a very typical thing, again, that a so-called manual QE person who has all these rules of what kind of things might go wrong could do. Whether it adds anything to the coverage is another story, but at least we're at 162 test cases. So what I was doing here, and why I was showing this to you, is that what we're basically doing here is learning in layers, and what I was demoing is what I call manual quality assurance, or testing. I was manually creating ways of executing something that I needed to test. It just happened to be a method, like an API. So what I showed was exploratory unit testing of legacy code. Legacy code as in it was already in production. That's how this Gilded Rose kata has been specified. It is legacy code. It is really messy. You're supposed to get it under tests before you make the changes so that you know things around that. So it was unit testing and exploratory testing at the same time. What I was also doing is I combined my ideas of the world, like the binary numbers, the specification, oh yes, days 5 and 10 are somehow special for these concert tickets, the code and the code coverage while I was testing. So I could use all of that information. I didn't quite complete. I wouldn't call myself done at the end of the 160-something test cases, but I did, you know, already get some of it under coverage, under control, and I already have at least $2 to report around the shorthand in the specification and around the let's talk about, is binary even intended? Should we do something about this? What kind of things will we need in relation to this? I used very little time, so my testing was definitely shallow. And if I would use more time, if I would learn on more layers, then that would probably be taking me a lot further. And the special thing, or the most important thing out of this demo, is really this idea that I was creating test automation. At first it was disposable, because I didn't feel like copy-pasting. I could have copy-pasted, I could have kept every single test and run them again later on. But the other tool was really telling me to kind of like, you know, easily generate those values. So it was easing up my way of creating that documentation. I still don't care to keep that documentation for the purposes of my testing. But it might actually be useful to have that documentation around for whatever development purposes we have. So test automation is disposable documentation. You can keep it or you can throw it away. So that's how exploratory testing actually happens in this world. And a lot of times what I see is these kind of pictures that place exploratory testing on kind of like as a icing on the cake, that there's all these different layers of other kinds of tests that you're doing before. And then the manual exploratory testing is there on the top. But we were actually doing this layer here with the demo. And yet we were doing that. So it has never actually been there on the top. We have just put it there on the top. It's always been a part of every single layer here. So what I usually do with this picture is like, please don't show it. Please don't make it go around. Draw it differently. That little cloud needs to be clouding some part of all of these different layers of our test automation pyramid. So exploratory testing is really something that drives our creation of automation. And we can make choices whether we keep things for us or not. So let's still talk a little bit more about the APIs specifically. So the API that I showed you, right now was a very, very low level for the purposes of not having to use network and not having to introduce you into anything more complicated than that. I have also, of course, examples on using public APIs and checking values on them. Very same principles apply there as well. Like if you can see the whole headers and whole responses, rather than choosing just one that you picked, handpicked to be looked at, you're going to find surprising things out there. But the same principle, you know, you can do that on REST APIs, you can do that on libraries, frameworks, languages, methods, command line interfaces, and pretty much any kind of interfaces that we are creating these days. And there's absolutely no reason of leaving the critical thinking with your application as your external imagination telling you hints on you'd want to do this, you'd want to try these values. You don't want to leave that for later on. So you want to do this already earlier. And it's not that complicated. You just do something with it. You find out why would anyone want to use it? What's the common thing of what to do with it? And you try things that you were not supposed to be doing with it as well, making sure you're learning as much as possible in layers so that you're always in control. So don't start with the most eccentric case at the time when you understand nothing yet about the application. That's not proper exploring. But kind of knowing where your home base is and taking trips from there, keeping safe, that's what we do in exploratory testing. So having done this for various applications, for example, for that approval test framework that I was using as part of my testing demo, I've collected some patterns. The reference that the approval testing framework, the creator, gave me is that I looked at his framework and his APIs for like an hour and a half and I totally destroyed it. But actually, I didn't destroy it. The only thing that got destroyed was the illusions of it ever having worked properly. So showing things around discoverability, showing things around how you use that in an IDE, how you set up a realistic environment, all of those things were surprises to them rather than things that they were already aware of. But they were things other people were experiencing. And to get some of that message across to this person, I actually had to collect together a little bit of a mob of people in a conference. So when he watched about 10 people, recognized agile technical experts in a conference, not being able to use his API because it was way too complicated and undiscoverable, then he said basically he would rewrite that API. And rewriting APIs later on, you probably know, it's not going to be an easy thing to do when it's already in use in real projects. So that's been a problem since. So some of the patterns. You work with a limited understanding, so you need to focus. I talked about this idea that you are in control. Whenever you are that tester, you are the center of that process. And you are in control of what is it that you can learn, what you can grasp, what you can do. So if you can take big steps, because you understand all of those things, you know, by all means, take big steps. But it might be helpful to do this kind of like a switching between sometimes taking smaller steps, sometimes taking bigger steps, because it enables you to see things that you had not seen before. So I often find myself not doing the same thing twice. Even if I do the supposedly same thing, I can at least use a different set of data. And it is always a chance for seeing new things. But focus, deciding what you're doing, making those choices is important. You look at what goes in, what comes out. And this is kind of straightforward, but it is important to see all of the things that go in and all of the things that come out. So making sure that you're open to those surprises and you don't already kind of narrow your lens is something that I would advise as a good pattern for exploring on APIs. Then understanding that the environment might also have somewhat of an impact. So probably there's going to be some dependencies, versions of whatever other software that people have in different ways. And your test environment can include those. And it changes what you will learn. Looking at your users, what the users look like, and in particular, the developer experience is the user for our APIs. I don't know, but I have at least heard a great number of swearing from my developer colleagues using third-party APIs available in various platforms. Not only on how easy or difficult it is to build things on the first time, but oh my gosh, how difficult it is when something then fails in production and you have to go and dig in where the failure is. Is it our things or that third-party thing? And having information available for that purpose. So the experience is both right now and also for the later. Asking for the purpose is also a good pattern. Why would anyone want to use this? What's the purpose of this data? It's not because someone specified it. There was a greater reason behind it. So maybe we'd want to ask around it. And not just asking why would they want to use it, but also think of it as in, it's gonna have a life cycle. It's gonna be there, you know, for the first time. It's gonna be updated. We're gonna want to change it. And all the practices around how do we version our APIs, like that's probably one of the most painful areas where I have to find problems at too late stages of the project. If we haven't thought about the way we version our APIs, and we really have to always be backwards and forwards compatible with all of our changes. So knowing that, talking about that, making that information available and part of your discussions is an important thing. And of course, killing it is relevant as well. If you learn a concept that you don't know, like I did when I started working on APIs, like I heard about conservative overloading strategy, you know, figure out what does it mean. If someone uses words you don't know and you don't want to ask in the moment, I usually rather ask in the moment, there's always Google. So every day is a chance of understanding this a little bit more. And you don't have to do all of this alone. Collaboration is always encouraged. Documentation, it matters. For approval tests in particular, the documentation was images of code samples. You can imagine how much that annoys a developer when you can't even copy paste. So again, a bug of relevance, even if not directly in that particular code. And your exploration creates documentation just as much as any other form could. I actually want to move into this one. Last pieces of advice. The role of automation into this is that when you're working on an API, you really have even the so-called manual QAs doing automation. Saying anything other is kind of funny. They might not know all things programming, but they can do this stuff, even if they very much identified as non-programmers and manual QAs. So for them, or in general, the existing automation that you already have, that someone who knows more of code maybe, it allows them to use it and play with it and, you know, generate, for example, hundreds of similar things, many events rather than just one, or start actively changing some input values and play with it and then use that for documentation. When you create automation, it really is like you're looking into details. So you see problems that you never did if you didn't go on the code level. So that's a good side as well. And when the automation then fails, because it does fail, it always does fail, and not always because our software is broken, it is an invitation for us to go and explore some more. So there's actually no difference in how the manual QAs do things to how the automation QAs do things, except that the manual QAs are just starting their journey on learning how to work with that code. And you should bring them closer to that work. So to sum this up, we have really two kinds of testing. We have what I would call testing as artifact creation. Usually this is very much the side that we see on the test automation communities. That kind of automation or that kind of testing gives us specifications, You know, we know what we're building if we have an example at hand. Feedback, did we actually build whatever we specified that we were supposed to? Regression, does it stay working after we created that? And granularity, when it fails, this is the reason. It documents the reason. And that's all awesome, great and wonderful. Whereas the exploratory part is what kind of grows this and makes it bigger. And it is requiring attending to create more of that automation. It gives us more of a guidance. This direction is better than that direction. It gives us deeper understanding. We can model things. We can create ideas of what we already know and what we don't know. And serendipity, lucky accident of finding the problems that we otherwise have to experience first time in production. And not all of them very happy and nice. And all of these things just go on continuously as we are making, hopefully, releases all the time. There's just a little bit different peak times of them, so you can explore while in production, even for your APIs. So that's kind of what I had in mind. As final thing, I want to encourage people to remember that learning is the most powerful thing. This is part of almost all the talks that I do nowadays. If you stay the same, you're still the same in a year. If you get 1% better, whatever that way of growing is, you're going to be 37.8 times better than you were in 1 year. So there's nothing better than learning, and I feel that exploratory testing at its core, it's only about learning, and the expert nowadays are the ones who learn the fastest, not the ones who know the most. So that's the thought that I want to leave you with. Thank you.
So thank you so much.
Welche APIs sind meine Topseller? Welche Applikationen, welche Konsumenten rufen meine APIs am meisten auf? Wo macht es am meisten Sinn, rein zu investieren?
So thinking big should really be seen through this lens of platforms and ecosystems.
Und deswegen können wir hergehen und können unseren echten Backend-Server gegen die Functional Essence vergleichen.